All right. Now this special is a little different because it's all, it's family. You got pointers, knock yourself out. I'm all ears.
You can be family, but be outrageous. Drop some M bombs. Drop some MM bombs. Drop some S bomb. B, Y, S.
No one's.
Foul language.
I'm not being foul, but thank you.
Just make sure it's funny. That's all you gotta do. Funny. Funny how? You know how.
Jonas is an guys. Is this out of Prince of Darkness?
I'm really sorry, Ozzy. I don't.
Let's get crazy!
Alright, listen.
Sharon!
All I gotta do is be funny. I'm gonna do laughter for all. Laughter for all. Done.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Jim Breuer.
Thanks for coming out, man, especially if you got families. Nothing against young people, but your life is so easy, you have no clue. It's just basically you want to go out and you go, yeah! That's how simple life is. You want to go out? Yeah! Let's stay out all night. Let's get on a train and go across the country tonight. We'll quit work, I got no money, who cares? We'll live on a freight train for 3 weeks. I'll call Subway, tell them I can't make it. I'll text them. It's harder once you become an adult. You have to pick and choose what you're gonna do, like events. If you're gonna really go out, you pick your events. Like my wife and I, the last time we went to an event was probably over a year ago. I'm not talking like going out, finding a babysitter and that. I'm talking about an event. And I took her to a concert, which you don't do when you're domesticated with kids. What you do is shows. That's what you used to. You used to go into a place where they have a brochure and you walk in like, oh, look. Brad Garrett is in this. How exciting. Oh, and he'll be singing. You're looking at the theater. I heard Abbott and Costello was in here at one time. Such a lovely theater. Look, they're bringing back Cats. How exciting. So that's what I'm used to. So, you know, we go to a concert. Now, I have to preface by saying concert. I grew up a metalhead. I love 80s. Yeah, 80s metal. Like, Metallica, yeah. A lot of yes and oohs with this. Yeah. You know, and AC/DC and all those guys, yes. Now listen, here's the funny part about metal is, first of all, it's getting old. Now that, if you listen to metal, there's no young metal good bands out there that I'm listening to. It's becoming oldies. How scary is that? But you know what? Embrace it. I want to be that grandfather in the backseat of the car with my grandkids, just really not sure where I'm at. And when you get older, you just want music. That's the only thing that touches your soul. So I want to be in the back seat. Just, hey, could you turn on my station, please? What are we listening to? They're not even singing. And my grandkids are going, don't turn on his station, Mom. The station sounds like they're sacrificing animals. How great will that be, that moment where you're in that back seat, all us old 80s metal guys, and you hear, hey, you're listening to the oldies goldies station.
As we thank a good Lord for another breath of air today. This is going out to the class of 82. And if you're turning 82 today, this is for you. This is Metallica's Creeping Death.
And we're going to be in the back here. Die! 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 I'm creeping death! And we'll be in that back seat like this. You fucker!
Do you hear his lyrics? That's music right there. Die! Your grandfather's gonna die because there's creeping death on the way. Turn it up, turn it up, turn it up.
You know, you're gonna need us oldie metalheads. Stick us in nursing homes and assisted living. We are gonna rip those places up.
All the old metalheads, please come to the rec room for the wheelchair mosh pit hour. Line it up, Freddy. Turn on Megadeth.
Let me help you up, Mr. Breuer.
Don't you touch me! This is how we did it back in the day. You got me good, Charlie. You got me good.
Hey, you know what? Metal is just... Old metal is just... It's the Wiggles for adults. That's all it is. I'll tell you why it's the Wiggles. I'm telling you, it's the Wiggles. That's all it is. If you don't know metal, it's Wiggles. If you have little kids and you bring them to the Wiggles, my kids love the Wiggles. We got the Wiggles. Oh, God, the Wiggles, the Wiggles. I'm really disappointed in my life and career that I missed the boat on how to make real money. The Wiggles, I'm paying $150 a pop. And it's a guy with a yellow shirt. And my kid's like the Beatles. Oh, no, God, a yellow shirt. Can I get a shirt? I'm in line 40 deep. Can I get a yellow shirt? It's a Wiggle. And then they do their hit song and the place erupts. You know what their hit song is? Fruit salad. Yummy, yummy. And these kids are like, I need a fruit salad shirt! I need a fruit salad shirt! Please! Let me get the fruit salad shirt, the yellow one, the yellow one. But then I realized, metal, it's the same thing. It's just that we're older. 80s metal is the Wiggles, but it's for adults. That's all it is. That's all. It's great. Here, I'll prove it to you. Who's in Iron Maiden? Anyone in Iron Maiden? Okay. All right. Now, yes, you're in Iron Maiden. You love the music. Yeah, I get it. Well, let's be honest. When you go see Iron Maiden live, what are you really hoping shows up at that concert? For those of you going, what are they talking about? Eddie is a mascot. It's just a big skeleton. What is it? I don't know. But you'll stand there for an hour, going, hey, I like this song, and then all of a sudden, and then a grown adult, oh, man, it's Eddie! Eddie just came out. You're missing it, bro. You're missing it, bro. Let me get an Eddie shirt, two Eddie shirts. It's unbelievable. That's an Eddie. It's the Wiggles. Ozzy Osbourne, he's a Wiggle. I love him. Wouldn't Ozzy's voice be great on a GPS? It'd be entertaining but useless.
Calculating route.
It's my wiggle, though. So with that said, we go on our event. We're going to see a concert. And we're going to see Metallica live. Now, yeah, I totally tricked my wife. You know, I played the slow song.
Nothing else matters.
Oh, I like that song. It's not so scary.
Yeah, see? They changed. They evolved.
So we get to the show, all right? And we get there, we sit out. I forget. I'm domesticated now. She's like, is there a brochure? I'm like, all right. We're looking around the stadium, brochure, whatever. Now, here's when you know you're too old to be going to concerts. First of all, the name of the bands is already a tragic mistake. Here's the opener. So you ready for this? Just the names. Anthrax, Megadeth, and Slayer. Okay, all right, did you hear? All right, you hear that? Let me tell you something about Slayer fans. That was the scariest time of my life when the Slayer fans showed up. That's the first time I feared my own race. I'm not even kidding you. I feared my own race. They look like the extras from Lord of the Rings. Right before Slayer came out, someone came out and,
release the Slayer fans.
And they came out of nowhere, under the ground, tattooing their faces.
Slayer!
And I'm hovering my wife, like, everything's gonna be okay. We're only gonna be on for like 15 minutes.
Slayer! Slayer!
We're gonna be safe. So Slayer's about to go on right before Metallica. The lights go out. Now, I forget I'm domesticated, so when the lights go out of show, I still get that giddy feeling. Show starting. Because I'm used to, you know, Beauty and the Beast.
Why are they so mean to the Beast?
They don't get better, Daddy.
So. So the lights go out. And I hear. And I, is there a train coming? And I turn around, and there's about 500 Slayer fans, and they're heading right for the stage, and they're not using the aisles to get there. Chairs are being flung, people flying up in the air. And I looked at my wife like, every man for himself. I don't. We're doomed. I'll see you on the other side. I get run over. I'm 45 years old, and this crowd knocks me down. By the way, not one Slayer fan said, excuse me. So I'm on the floor. Now, listen. When you're 20, 25 years old, you get knocked to the floor, you get right up. You're like, huh. And you might even get a cheap shot of, hey, what's the prop? But I'm 45. You know, I take cardio kickboxing with soccer moms, and I rock it at 7 a.m. Kick, punch. But kick, punch, punch, uppercut. But I'm on Slayer, I'm down, and I can't get up. So every time I get up, another guy takes me.
And they keep coming by me, and I turn around, I get knocked down again. But now, I have responsibilities. So while I'm fearing for my life and trying to get up, I'm texting the babysitter.
It's gonna be a little later than I anticipated. Please apologize to your mother for me.
Now, I finally get up, and I'm in a tsunami of humans. And I end up about 3 feet from the stage. I didn't ask for these seats. And the Slayer starts.
Someone's getting sacrificed tonight. Most likely it'll be you.
Wait, me? Is he talking to me? He's talking to me. Oh, it's so crowded that my feet aren't touching the ground. So when the crowd moved, I have no control where I'm going. So
I guess we'll watch this guy for a while.
Okay, we're done with this guy. This guy's great. You guys know the stage is that way, right? I'm just saying. Took me about 15 minutes to finally get back to my seats. My wife's still missing to this day. I don't know where she's at. I've got 2 new tattoos on my rump. And I finally felt safe and I went, great. Metallica be on soon. These guys are done. And just when I started to go, oh, Slayer goes,
this is our last song.
Yeah.
So if you're a big Slayer fan, show everyone around you what Slayer fans are all about.
And I didn't get the brochure. I said, if you're a Slayer fan, pounce, punch, kick, throw down anyone 30 and over that looks confused. Like, what a bizarre place to be. Like, I love this song. Hey, what? Like, where have we come as a society where to show your enjoyment for something, that's how we react? Like, my parents... my dad's 90, my mom's 85 right now. They come from that World War II era. The whole world was at war. There was anger, there was alcoholism, there was a lot to be worried about. And so when they vented, they'd get crazy. But to them, this was crazy.
Give me a martini, I'm getting crazy.
Once in a while, a hand would go up, like, oh, she's getting nuts. How do we go from that to, I love this song? And as the smoke clears, there's one guy going, I'm your biggest fan! That was my last event. So yeah, I have to grow up. I have 3 kids. And yeah. Right. Like your attitude, brother. You would think that I'd be pretty open-minded with my kid. I'm very strict. My daughter's 13, still no phone. No phone. No. 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 And I don't negotiate. Why can't it? Because no. Give me a good reason. No and no. And they'll try everything with you. Well, you know,
Everybody in, like, America is 13 and has a phone, Dad.
Well, you don't. You're special. Be different. How exciting. I'm gonna be a cow like the rest of them? No. And this is, I get more grief from parents than actually, parents would come up to you like, you know, is that true about your daughter and not having a phone? 13? It's ridiculous. It's ridiculous. My child came out of the womb, gave her an iPad, right? I mean, it's socialism, pal. You got it. It's where they live. All right, let me ask you this. What happens? All right, what happens if your daughter is dropped off at the bus stop early?
Okay, that's a great question. And she walks 50 feet to the house. Like, where's your kid getting dropped off? Is that a dilemma in America? They're dropping us off in Iowa by accident? Like, this kid's walking around a corn store. And he's like, I can't believe it. We're stuck in Iowa again. If I only had a phone, it's... Diane, I can't see you. It's a stupid bus. I don't have a phone either. Like, what are you talking about?
This is the other one I got. This guy's like, excuse me. All right, let me ask you this, okay? Does your child play sports?
Yeah, she plays, yeah, sport.
Okay. Huh. What happens if your child goes to sports practice and it's done early, huh? What happens then?
I go, wait, where are you dropping your kids off? What, are they stuck in a gymnasium for like a week on?
They left me here! I'm all alone and I can't get out! I can't believe this is happening!
Like, how can you not know your coach? How can you not know some other teammates and have contacts? Like, what are you just showing up behind like a shopping mall where the Mexicans play soccer? You know that one field in your town where you're like, oh, that's where the Mexicans play soccer. And they're into it, they're fantastic. You know, and you're yeah. And you show up going, hey, amigos, my daughter wants to play. She's really good on defense, so we don't have a phone, so I'll come back in like 45 minutes. Have fun with the amigos, will you, hon? What about this one? You ever get this?
All right. Your daughter doesn't have a phone. What if there's an emergency in school?
All right, let's say that. All right, let's say the kid is on the floor, she's foaming at the mouth, something happened. Maybe, I don't know, she had the wrong food, and then everyone's gathering around her like, oh my God, it's a little girl. She's like, what's your name?
It's Gabrielle.
Gabrielle, okay, well, there's nothing we can do for her, because she doesn't have a phone. It's definitely a challenge. The oldest one is at that age, she's beautiful, she's a teenager, you know, the boys are starting to look at her a certain way, and the boys show up, I don't know what I'm gonna do. And I other men are like this, oh, you gotta get a gun.
Just clean the gun when they show up and I'll scare them.
That's not 100% proof, but I think I'm onto something. When that first boy shows up, I'm dressing like a transvestite.
Bing bong, hi Freddy.
Trying on my wife's clothes. She come join me, come on, you look good. Where'd you get them boots?
How come they never show up?
I don't know. Yeah, every kid is different. My middle kid, she's really funny, really funny. And she's clever, probably the most clever one in the bunch. Here's the irony of her being clever is she's got the Breuer look. Yeah, you know the look. The one that half you've been judging that you never see me live, like,
wow, he comes on stage looking like that.
So, and I didn't realize how funny this look was until I saw my daughter staring at a butterfly for an hour. And she, thank God that social services weren't doing spot checks. I would have been in bad trouble. Like, oh my goodness, we got a child. I don't know what she's on the front. So this kid looks wrecked. She's wrecked. She's, and her face is all relaxed. She can't even speak. Like, what are you doing?
A butterfly. A butterfly, Dad. A butterfly.
And this lady pulled up as she gets out of the car. And she's concerned for my daughter. She's coming up to my door, and I'm watching. She's going, sweetheart, there's something wrong with this child, Charlie. Sweetheart, are you okay? What's going on with you today? She doesn't even acknowledge her.
She's a butterfly. Butterfly.
Did someone give you a brownie today? There's something wrong with this child. Call the police. Who is with this child? And then that's when I have to come out.
Excuse me. She's with me, and we're checking out butterflies, if you want to join us. Here's a butterfly.
You laughing at my kid's face? By the time you hit the third one, I find myself lying just to not deal with it. You know, the poor kid will come like, Dad, can we go to the park? Oh, man, it's closed. I wanted to go, and I Googled it, said closed. It's a beautiful day. And then I got in the car, and it's broke down. The only thing working is the game that Dad's watching. It's so annoying. So annoying. It's aggravating. It's not fair. It's not fair. You know, but... Because you can't reason with kids. I don't reason with a kid. My daughter hits the floor and starts whining. I just step right over them. I go, let me know that works out. This is a high kidnapping area, so be careful. My wife, though, she'll engage with the little one. And I tell you, that's when a relationship is really, really challenged, because you're supposed to stick together as a team raising a child. They tell you that. You got to stick together. But it's hard sometimes when you walk into a situation. You know, picture yourself walking in, and my little one was on the floor. She's screaming. My wife's broken. She broke my wife. Broke her right in half. Snapped. My wife snaps, she starts counting, thinking this will make it better. It just adds the chaos. So I walk in, and she's like, get up! This is what I walk into. I come out of the car happy, like, hey, I'm home, isn't this great? Hang out with the kids, boom, there it is. Get up off the floor! You're acting completely out of control right now, and I don't know where you got this from! You don't get it from anyone in this house, I'll tell you that right now. I'm gonna start counting to five. And when I get to five, I swear to you, if you're not up off the floor and in your bedroom getting ready with your pajamas on, I'm putting you up for adoption. Do you understand me? One, I've just started counting, you're not even moving because you don't listen. Nobody listens in this house. You want a phone? You're never gonna get a phone because I've asked you 10 times to clean the kitty litter. Nobody does their chores, and nobody don't ask for anything from now. Two, you haven't moved since I started counting, because you don't believe me. You think you haven't? Do you act this way in school? Do you act this way in school? I'm going to start videotaping you, and I'm going to send it to your teacher. This is your student. I don't know what she's like in the classroom, but at home, she's completely out of control. And maybe you can do something about this. I'm filing the papers as we speak. There is still kitty dung in the kitty litter. I can smell it. Do your chores or you never get... Whose shoes are these? I'm throwing them out.
Floor! Get up off the floor right now.
And then she sees you, and then you, as a father, ask a question that you think is just a common sense question for this situation. What's going on? And apparently, that's like bringing up a lion feeding. I had no clue that now it's on me. What's going on? Did you just ask me? You just asked me what's going on. Don't you dare come in our house. We built this house together. Me and you were together long before any of you children ever existed. Kitty litter, I'm not gonna say it again. Don't you dare come in this house insinuating a situation at hand. You think I'm the bad guy? You didn't see what has led up to the situation that is driving me mad. You know I'm not normally like this. These things drive me to this. Don't you ever come in here and ask me what's going on. You want to know what's going on? You want to really know what's going on? Ask your daughter what's going on.
Tell your father why you're completely out of control right now. Four and a half.
And just like in every movie, when it looks like your hero has finally met his doom, the unsung hero comes out of nowhere to save the day. And that's my middle kid. She comes out of nowhere. I don't know what to do. She comes in from outside. Hey, Dad. Oh. Oh. Okay, here's the situation at hand, Dad. I would have never walked into this situation, but you did, so let me explain what's going on. She's on the floor because she asked Mom if we can go to the park today, because she clearly knew you were lying. She's at that age. And Mom said, yeah, we can go to the park today as long as Mommy gets to finish all the things that Mommy needs to do. Well, she clearly didn't hear any of that. All she heard was, we're going to the park. So she barraged Mom with about 37 straight, when we go to the park, you said we go to the park. What about the park? You said we're going to the park, when we go to the park. At about number 17, Mom snapped into the current condition she's in and said, we're going to the park so you can witness me burning it down so you can never go to a park again, ever. She then dropped to the floor, which is very effective at the grocery store and the malls, but it doesn't work at home. You need to understand that. But I'm here for the iPad. Can I borrow the iPad so I can look up the origins of a monarch butterfly? Dad, I suggest you come with me outside. I'm with you. Let's get out of here. My wife needed a break. And don't feel bad, mothers, because she felt bad because she was like, I think I want to get rid of the kids. Don't you feel bad? I saw a couple of you belly laughing. You feel bad because they do that to you. So I said, this is what I said, listen, here's what we're gonna do. I'm gonna take the kids for a week. You call one of your friends and you take a trip. Meep, meep. I
All right, it's just us, gang. I didn't even finish the sentence. She was out of there, jetpack. Landed in Aruba. So I turn to my kids, because that's another thing. You got to entertain them. They want entertainment. And if you don't have other kids, you're in trouble. So half the kids are out in camp or whatever. So I go, okay, gang, here's what we're going to do. You guys pick one thing we can all do together this week. It's got to be free. And it's got to be family friendly, okay? Now, the little clever one comes back 10 minutes later. Dad, we were all listening to the radio. I live in New Jersey, and they have this place in Jersey, which I didn't really know about. She goes, Dad, there's this place right here in New Jersey. It's called Great Adventure Safari Park. Oh, you already know what I'm talking about. All right, so you're going to know this. And I didn't believe them. I'm like, Great Adventures. Yeah, it's a safari, but you take your car and you drive through the zoo and the animals are wild. It's like being on a real safari, but with your car. And it's free with a can of Pepsi. You bring a can of Pepsi, it's totally free. All right, see, you know what I'm talking about. I went, you heard that wrong. Can of Pepsi free? Yes, it said great entertainment for a can of Pepsi. Great Adventure Safari Park. So can we go? And when they're on something, forget. Can we go? 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 You said we can go. We're going in the car. We got a case of Pepsi. They had a case of Pepsi sitting in the car. Beep, beep. You said we can go. It's free. Come on, can of Pepsi. Beep. We go. It's free. It's family friendly. You said it. We Googled it. We got your phone. We already Googled it. So there. So I'm driving, and I'm annoyed, because there's no way. Going through a safari and it's a can of Pepsi, I'm not buying it. So I'm mad, I'm driving down there, and I'm like, you know, if I gotta pay $80 to see a stupid zebra and a peacock,
Dad, it's free, okay? With a can of Pepsi, it'll be free. You'll see when we get in here. Now, this is what I was thinking, Dad. If it's free with a can of Pepsi, right, you can drive around. Now, since we got a case, shouldn't we be able to just drive around and around?
No, that's not how it works. Well, I'm going to ask them. All right, well, you do that. Now we get to Great Adventure Safari Park. The first thing I see is long line, really long line to get in. But I noticed that's to get in to the roller coasters and stuff. And I look to my left, and they're like, Dad, it's over there. And there's a safari park entrance. Red flag number one, nobody's online. Pull up, and I don't know where they found this poor woman. I think they took her out of the nursing home for the day, just get her air. Like, Marge, you want to collect tickets today? Collect tickets. Come on, get the chair, pull the car up. We're going to go see animals and collect tickets today. So we pull up, and there's little Marge. She's at the ticket booth. She's not even looking at us. She's like, welcome to Great Adventure Safari Park. The animals are wild. They are dangerous. Do not open up your window to attempt to feed the animals. They will try to get in your car. It is $89.99 per person. Look at the kids. Are you kidding me? Unless you got a can of Pepsi, then it's free. Which now all three kids look at me and go, Hold on a second. It's free with a can of Pepsi. Yep, it's our radio promotion. It's great entertainment for a can of Pepsi. All right. Are the animals alive?
Oh, they're very alive. And my daughter goes, ask them about the case of Pepsi. I'm like, oh, you got a case of Pepsis and you can drive around and around.
So, a little word to the wise, if you ever go to this place, bring a rental. Because, first of all the animals are waiting for you. Doing, oh, we got a visitor! We got a visitor!
There's one elephant, he's missing his one of his legs are turned in.
But when you get it, there's all these baboons waiting for you. Not monkeys, baboons. And literally, soon as the gate opened, the baboons are on your car trying to rip it to pieces.
He's on the side view mirror working this thing for 10 minutes.
And I can only go 10 miles an hour. That's the law. So they're walking alongside your car, staring at you. And they're ripping the hubcaps off and the lining on the hubcaps. And they completely engulf your car. And the kids are starting to get freaked out. Because they're in the window staring at them. And the kids are going, Dad? Dad, are we safe?
I'm not gonna give you false hope. I don't know. I've never been to a place where they're ripping the car apart and there's nobody in sight to help us except for Marge.
So we put the car in park because nobody's there. And then all of a sudden the ostriches come out of nowhere. Like, yeah. And they instantly attack the car, a big ostrich leg. And I hear my car, the metal just crunching. And these guys are working on the hubcaps and the side view mirror. And I'm trying to make them go away. I'm hitting the gas. None of them are moving. Now I see there's one ostrich checking me out. And I feel like he's trying to challenge me. So I roll down the window. And he sticks his head in. And so he's looking at me. He's looking at the kids. He's looking at me. I'm like, wow, it's a wild animal. So I take my phone, I give it to my daughter, I'm like, quick. Put it on camera. I'm gonna grab his neck and put my face next to that. But that's when I realized he was sizing me up. Cause soon she's like, all right, Dad, I got it on camera. I went to grab me, ducked, and he wailed me. And I was knocked out for about 3 seconds. The only reason I know is because when I came to, my kids were in my face going, Dad! Oh my gosh, you were sleeping really hard. You're going this really quick with your eyes. And when I came to and I felt like, what's going on? He hit me again. But now he didn't knock me out. So now I'm fighting this thing. I'm fighting the ostrich. He's taking a whack at me. And I'm like, I've been a slayer. I do not fear an ostrich. So we're going at it. He's ducking, hits me in the belly and I'm trying to grab him. And we're going. And I start laughing. And as I laugh, he hits me. Because it's funny. At the end of the day, I'm fighting a bird. And I'm not even fighting a whole bird. I'm fighting a neck and a head. And I'm losing. I'm losing to a neck and head. Hey, so I finally get the car and drive, take off. I ran over at least two baboons. I heard them. And I can't see from all the dust. I'm just looking for the exit. And I turn on the windshield wipers, and I don't have any. fucking weeks. And I look in the rearview mirror, and there's the baboons next to the ostriches with my windshield wipers. Sign of victory. And I'm leaving there. My head's all busted up. I have nothing left in the car. And the kids are like, oh, Dad, we're really sorry. And I said, don't, you know what? Don't be sorry, because for a can of Pepsi, that was great entertainment. Unbelievable. All right. This is when I knew I was going to go into stand-up comedy. My first real job was at a department store called Sears. And I worked in the paint department. And I ruined a lot of homes. You know, people come in like, oh, I'm thinking about painting my bedroom. What should stain it? Yeah, young, I don't care. So, but that's when I discovered I can do voices and I can do characters. And I would call departments all day long and drive them nuts. So that's before Saturday Night Live and all that. That's where the Pesci really came from. Me and my friend, we saw Raging Bull and Easy Money. And I would call my friend in toy department on like Cabbage Patch Day. It was the 80s, you know. And he'd pick up the phone, like, hello, this is Scott, toy department. I'm very busy. Can I put you on hold? I'm like, listen, this is Joe Pesci. I'm coming in here 20 minutes. Don't put me on hold, kid, because I'm coming right in here. You put me on hold, I'm going to stick your head up where the sun don't shine. You understand me? You understand what I'm saying? So I would call all these other departments and drive them nuts. So this one day, I'm in the hardware department, next department over. And I'm reading about Muammar Gaddafi. In the 80s, he was huge. Big. He was a rock star in the 80s. He was the first one that was like, I do not fear America. You tell me I can not have fly, no fly zone? You send your military here, your Air Force, I'll shoot you down. It was intense. So, you know, we were like, did he just say he's going to shoot us down? Send a plane. So we sent an Air Force there, and he shot missiles at a U.S. Air Force, he missed, everyone he missed. And then we bombed his tent. I'm not even trying to be funny. It was the tent, and that's what we bombed, and we missed him. So the point is, it was pretty intense back then with Muammar Gaddafi. Everyone knew who he was. So with that said, I'm reading the paper. The new guy from hardware comes. He goes, excuse me, you work here? I said, yeah, I'm Jim. I work in the paint department next department over. I was just reading about all this crazy stuff, like you might go to war and stuff, Muammar Gaddafi. I go, listen, if you need anything, let me know. Everyone knows me here. He goes, you know what I need? I need you not to be reading a paper in the hardware department. That's a reflection on me. You know, you're young. All you guys are young. And you don't realize that some people, you need to respect the job you work at. I know everything about the craftsman tools. I know everything about the different size of the hammers. And I'm here to help people. You understand? That's what you're really getting paid to do, to help people. So if you work in paint, you know what you can do for me? Please go back to paint. Wow, you're serious, huh? You know this is Sears, right? Because, yeah, and they give you a salary, and you should respect that. You're right. So I'm hot-headed. And I go to paint department, and my friend's like, what's big doofy kids? What's the matter? I said, the new guy kicked me out. He said, he knows everything about craftsman tools, and I shouldn't be reading the paper and the hammer, so blah, blah, blah. He goes, give him a call. He doesn't know you're the call guy. He doesn't know you're a clown. Give him a call. So I'm going to call him. I said, what? He goes, what are you doing? So I was reading the paper about Muammar Gaddafi. He goes, call us Muammar Gaddafi. I said, that's so stupid, but we'll do it anyway. My hand to God, I'm not even gonna exaggerate this. He's about 50 feet from me. 50 feet.
Not yards, feet. I can see him. I hear the phone ringing. I'm not even hiding completely behind the register. My head's sticking up. And this guy's in full view going, here he comes. He's answering. So the guy picks up the phone and he goes, hello, this is Greg. Sears Hardware, Valley Stream, New York. How may I help you? Hand to God, I go, hello. This is the great Muma Kuntafi.
He's listening.
I have just sent 6 of my Libyan missiles to blow up the Sears Hardware Department. You have 20 minutes to evacuate all of the craftsman tools and all of the hammers and the people of the hardware. As long as I am the great Muma Gaddafi, you remember this, my hardware friend. Long live paint! So, yeah, that's not the funny part. So my friend and I went into the break room, which was attached to the paint department. You leave, you go in the stock room, and it leads to the break room. And that's where we would take tag team 1-hour breaks into the mall. He'd leave for an hour, come back. I'd leave for an hour, come back. An hour, 4-hour shifts. We get paid for them. We work 2. 20 minutes go by and I realize, let me get into paint, nobody's there. I get there and I call a guy from hardware to let him know it was me, I was just breaking you in, my apologies. Let's just make amends. He doesn't answer the phone. So now I decide, I'm gonna snitch on him because you have to answer the phone. I'm gonna tell my supervisor. So I call my supervisor and he doesn't answer. So then I call my friend from toy department, and he doesn't answer. And that's when I realize nobody's in the store. And I'm not comprehending what's really going on. I'm really confused. Like, why is nobody in Sears right now? There's no customers. There's no sales clerk. What is going on? I don't know. And I'm standing there, and all of a sudden, someone comes from the stock room and says, Breuer, let's go! What are you doing? We got one more. Come on, right now! Now, I saw the panic in his eyes, and I didn't ask questions. I thought there was a fire. So I was like, okay, let's go! We're running, and we're out of there. And while we're running through the stock room, I go, I don't smell a fire. Where's the fire? And he goes, there's no fire! The new guy in hardware got a bomb threat! We're gonna blow up in 5 minutes! I did what you did, I laughed hard! I said, that wasn't a bomb threat! That was me! I said I was, like, are you kidding me? That guy took that as a bomb threat? That's what, seriously? Listen, I said I was Muma Gaddafi, and I sent missiles to hit Sears Hardware. I ended by saying, long live paint. How do you get a bomb threat out of that? Are you kidding me? That's why all of Sears is evacuated. Yeah, and the mall. And the mall?
He goes, you gotta go downstairs, man. You're in bad trouble.
I said, I'm not in bad trouble. This is hilarious. I'm sorry, but that guy from hardware, I don't know who he is, but he's a suspect. There's something wrong with him. He's a suspect. He goes, there's a lot of cops downstairs, Breuer. You're in bad trouble. I said, there's cops? Let's go talk to them. They're gonna love this story. So I go downstairs, and there's a lot of police officers. And
I swear to you, the higher the rank, the harder they laughed. I worked all the way up to the sergeant. They're like, hold on. Bring the sarge through. Sarge, come here. You got to do the hella man. You got to do that. You got to do that, Brewer. Come here. Wait till you hear this kid. It's hilarious. So the sergeant's howling. He's like, you should become a comedian. I'll tell you what, that guy is too much. The problem is, I think you're funny, but the feds are here, so good luck. It's out of our jurisdiction. If I was you, start off with the hello, man, hello, man. So the feds walk in. Three feds walk in, and they're a tougher audience.
Well, I don't know what the big joke is around here. I don't know if everyone thinks it's so funny. Okay? You know, I had to fly in from JFK International Airport. I had to warn Secretary of Defense of the situation. You think this is funny, kid? You think this is a big joke? Let me explain something to you. You don't get to call a lawyer, and you don't get to notify your parents. As far as anyone knows, I'm the U.S. government. I'm detaining you, and you're missing. Do you understand the situation you are in right now? No. I'm glad you're confident. You got 2 minutes to tell me your story, and you got to look my marshals in the eyes while you tell this story. So whatever the test was, I had to stop and look at each one of them in the eye. So I'm like, okay, I'm in paint. You know, and I call the guy, like, hello, man. As long as I am Muammar Gaddafi, long live paint! And that's why we're here. The marshal was serious for about 10 seconds, and he goes,
let him go, I'll do the paperwork. Give me the guy from hardware, he's a suspect. Thank you, God bless you. Thank you. Thanks so much. Thanks for coming out. All the best to you. Thanks so much. No one's better than you guys. Thank you. Have a good one. Be safe, and thank you so much. Good night, guys. Thank you.